Hi everybody, welcome back. I know a lot of you have been here all afternoon. Well, afternoon for us is probably either middle of the night or early morning where you are. But we just had the most fantastic live horn hangout with the Chicago Symphony Horns. We had a little break in the middle, changed the scenery a bit, and now I am so happy and proud to welcome one of my favorite tuba players in the entire world, Gene Picorni. Welcome to the Horn Hangouts.
Pleasure to be hanging out.
I've been trying to get you on the Horn Hangouts. Really, we wanted to have you on for such a long time, but it wasn't enough for me to do it virtually, you know, from webcam to webcam. We had to come to you.
Well, I'm glad you came through the distance.
We only just got you because you're about to leave.
That is a bit of a problem because I was thinking that I would bring the CSO York tuba live here in front of cameras
that.
And all this. And as of about 15 or 20 minutes ago, it went on a truck.
Yeah.
And it's going to be transported, hopefully safely, to Washington, D.C., and then
Carnegie
New York
Hall.
Carnegie Hall, and then down to Florida and North Carolina. And
well,
places.
Let's hope it makes it safely. But I'll just have to come back and we'll do a special CSO tuba hangout, and you'll have to just play to us for hours.
I'll bring the donuts.
Good. Where are the donuts? We didn't get any donuts.
I know.
You've made yourself very chic for the hangout. Can you just explain your tie, please?
Well, this is a tie that I usually wear for Friday afternoon concerts and Sunday afternoon concerts.
You wear that in public?
Only when Muti's conducting, because as you can tell, it's a pizza tie.
It is.
And I have some Three Stooges ties that I wear for most everything else, and and various Three Stooges ties.
Yes, we'll get onto that in a second. Yeah.
But this is the Muti tie.
You just finished a rehearsal with him, but you didn't wear that at the rehearsal.
No.
But he's in town, so you never know. He might be in his dressing room around the corner still.
That's why you always give the illusion of having respect. Because
always.
It's very,
giving the
very
illusion
important
is
way.
Well,
it's easy to do it for real
of
for
course,
him.
Of yeah. course. And this little tag here, this your pin?
Oh, yeah. This is a Union Pacific pin. I'm a railroader. I'm a rail fan. Railroaders call people like me foamers because we stand by the railroad tracks. We foam at the mouth.
Foamers?
Yes. Yeah, I think they
We call
they
you called? Anoraks in England, the train
really?
Spotters. Yeah, anoraks.
Train spotters. Yeah,
yeah. Anoraks are the plastic, the really ugly plastic coats you put on if it's raining, well, you know.
Oh.
And because they're always out in their anoraks in any weather, so we call them anoraks,
wow.
Train spotters.
That's
we'll get onto that as well.
My goodness.
I know.
We have a lot of topics.
We've got a lot to get onto. Oh, yes, not only are you a train spotter and the president of the Three Stooges fan club, are you still the president?
I never was the president.
Did I hear that from?
Probably,
it was written online.
Well, if it's in Wikipedia, it must be true.
It must be true.
No, that's one. And I never was in the U.S. Marine Band.
Okay, that's good to set that straight.
I wish I would have been.
But that's in Wikipedia as well.
I know. There's lots of stuff that's
Cross
there.
Cross that off my list to talk about.
Indeed. You don't have to talk about the U.S. Marine Band.
That's okay. All right. Well, we won't do that. Scott Irvine, who's watching. Hey, Scott. Said, my favorite curly routine is oyster stew. What is your favorite curly routine?
It would have to be from the Three Little Pirates.
Okay, when what does he do there?
Well, there's a bunch of kind of gibberish dialogue between Moe and Curly, and they were both brothers, and they grew up in a household out in Brooklyn, and their parents were Jewish, and they heard a lot of Yiddish when they were growing up, and so they come up with this absolutely crazy stuff that just doesn't have anything to do with anything, and they're talking to one another, but it somehow somehow makes some sense, and everybody kind of knows what it's about.
Well, so. I must explain, because not everybody knows the Three Stooges in Europe. They should, of course.
Of course.
A couple of the young people I'd spoken to, they didn't know who the Three Stooges were. So we've prepared something. It's when Curly plays the tuba.
Oh, the bassoon!
We'd just like to show that to our viewers now.
Oh.
So we hope you guys enjoyed that. I know all tuba players watching that will know exactly why we are showing that, even if we hadn't explained it and they just tuned in. And those of you who may not have known the Three Stooges, go and Google them, YouTube them, you know, that it's, you just got to know them, right? Gosh, there's so much to talk about. Okay, we better get off the Three Stooges now, because we'll get back to the tuba playing, because apart from all that, you are a tuba player, and quite a good one. And I just wanted to tell the viewers where, well, we met first of all here when I was playing at Ravinia. You know, I was a little guest. I came in, Baron Boehm had invited me to come and play with the orchestra, and I was playing 100th horn in Mahler 2 and sat directly in front of you and Charlie. And you
lived to tell the tale.
No, I remember hearing Charlie say to you, "Hey, Gene, there's a new girl. She's kind of hot." I thought, I looked around and there were no more girls around except Alice, and I didn't think they were talking about Alice, who was Dale's wife, because she wasn't a new girl. She was hot, but she wasn't a new girl. So I assumed he meant me, which is very nice. I can't remember your answer. I think I turned bright red. But I remember when you breathed in for the first time, and I felt my hair being sucked into the... I heard this incredible... It was the first time I'd experienced this famous Chicago Symphony... big breathing.
It's infectious when I first came to the orchestra, because I wasn't breathing that deeply. I didn't have to in St. Louis. We had a really great acoustical setting there at Powell Symphony Hall. You could play a note and it resonated. Here at Orchestra Hall, it's a whole different thing. You have to really make up for a lot of resonance. And then hearing Charlie take a deep breath, I mean, that'll make your ears pop.
It sucked my hair in.
I'm sure he was very proud about that.
I'm sure he is. I actually had my first breathing lesson with him, because I'd called Jake, and unfortunately Jake had no time that week to see me, and I wish he had, Arnold Jacobs. Because I never met him. He was not feeling well, and unfortunately he died quite soon after that, so I never got to meet him, which I really regret, because I've always really admired him. But I went, I said, ask Charlie if I could go have a lesson, and he was like, sure. and he said, okay, so breathe in deep, and I took the biggest breath I could, and I was about to explode, and he said, did you breathe yet? And that was my first breathing lesson, so I learned a lot. And Charlie was here before you.
He was here in 86. I didn't start here till 1989.
So, but you had big shoes to fill when you came.
Oh, gosh, yeah. Yeah, it was, I was scared of this place. I mean, I came in for lessons with Arnold Jacobs, and the place was just so big and all these tall buildings, and he was I got a lot of good out of those lessons, and I know when I went back to the other places where I was playing, in the Utah Symphony at the time. I came out here for a week of lessons, had about three or four lessons. I went back to Utah, had my first rehearsal, and this violinist came up to me and he said, "What happened to you?" I said, "What do you mean, what happened to me?" I said, "Your whole sound is different." And I had never talked to this guy before. I mean, we were, you know, we knew each other and that, you know, "Hi, Richard," you know. But he said, "Your whole sound is different." And coming from a string player way on the other side, I thought, wow, that this week must have really had a difference. I mean, there were definitely some changes that...
What were the changes he made? Because there's so many people writing in here. French horn one. All the French horns stayed up for your. They're still watching. Who has been your most influential teacher? And I mean, it must have been Jake.
Well, Jacob certainly was very big in that part of my life. I'd say, I think probably the very first one who had a really big influence was Larry Johansson, who was a trumpet player out in Redlands, and he simply was not impressed by what I was doing, you know. And I was coming out of high school. I thought I was, you know, I knew all the fingerings. I mean, you know, and he insisted that I set my standards a little bit higher. And then definitely Jeff Reynolds, who was just a total hero, former bass trombone of the LA Philharmonic. I wanted to be just like him. You know, in fact, I was playing bass trombone for a while, and as soon as I heard Jeff play bass trombone, I said, well, I know what I'm having. You have a viola or something I can play? You know,
viola.
It didn't matter.
Yeah, right.
It didn't matter. And then, of course, Tommy Johnson was for 2 years, he was my regular teacher and the most consistent one, and he was the one who always cut all the fat out of the way and told me what I needed to hear. And
so what were these changes that Arnold Jacobs made with you to make this guy in Utah say it was suddenly different? Did you feel the difference yourself, or was it more you were surprised that he...
Well, I tell you, the first thing that got my attention from him was, he said, well, your sound's pretty good. But it could be much improved. And I was a little bit kind of, really? I thought it was pretty good, but tell me more. And he really insisted about using a lot more air, a lot more wind, using the syllables a lot more. And just to open up everything.
Yes, to keep everything,
the resonance going. And I was playing a relatively small instrument at the time. It was a Marafone 186, which was the standard operating instrument that those of us who were growing up in LA played. It's an instrument that was used a lot in recording studios. 186 actually was one of the larger ones, 185. Model 185, slightly smaller, is what Tommy Johnson used all the time, and Roger used a 184.
Roger Bobo.
Bobo, yeah, yeah. And what a sound that guy could produce.
Absolutely.
Just sinew, no fat, just, I mean, his first solo CD, I completely burned through the LP, sitting there in the trailer park listening to him, you know, on the old Magnavox.
In the trailer park.
Yeah,
you lived in a trailer park.
Yeah.
Oh, Gene! That wasn't on Wikipedia.
No. Yeah, you Wikipedia people. Why'd you put me in the Marine Band when I could have been at a trailer park? why not? I grew up very close to where they built the Apollo spacecraft that went to the moon.
Okay. What happened when you practiced in the trailer park, in your trailer? Isn't it a little bit small for a tuba?
Well, my folks own the trailer park, so no one could complain about the noise,
Okay. Did you ever practice outside?
I did occasionally. Yeah. But I tried to keep it, not too late at night. You know, I mean, it's still Southern California.
We have a USC alumni watching, Aya Matson, who said, how was your time at USC?
I spent 2 years there, and that's where I did all my study with Tommy Johnson, most all of it. Yes, yes.
And Justin Lerma says, can Gene talk more about the legend Tommy Johnson?
Tommy Johnson was one of these guys who could play anything, and he never made too much of a big deal about it. He was never after any fame or fortune. He just kind of sat in the back row and giggled to himself a lot of times. He'd just play everything perfect. And he could sight read things incredibly well. He had a great sense of time. And he just had everything together. I was very lucky to study with him, because he gave me actually a lot of the technical know-how of how to play the instrument. And it's not because he was, quote, a studio player. It's not that he wasn't moved by music. I mean, he was very much moved. He mentioned more than once how the second movement of the Ralph Vaughan Williams Tuba Concerto, he said that movement really sends me. That's how he put it. And it's and he had a beautiful sound, and just he and Roger Bobo were very close. They had an admirable relationship from what I could see from the outside. I don't know how it was on the inside, but from what I saw, they were extremely cooperative. They were very supportive of their students. They were very supportive of the other people's students. And, you know, if I brought in a piece of modern music to Tommy Johnson, and he'd listen to it and say, oh, you give me some pointers, and then say, you know, but Roger has a really good knack for music like this. Maybe you should go and see him. And so I go see Roger and work on it. And
how old were you at this time?
Oh, gosh. Well, it was high school, end of high school. So
end of high school, because we just had a question from John saying, how often did you practice when you were in high school? Were you a big practicer?
No.
No. Okay. Well, it's good to put that. Wikipedia can put that in as well.
No, No.
I know YouTuber players can go a bit crazy with practice because you don't get as tired as us horn players. You can go for hours.
Yeah, it's we have the potential to, and we don't have to think. We really don't, you know. I mean, there's so much of the time, you know. It's a lot of times you just put it on your horn, put the thing on your face, and you just keep going. And
John Fletcher said that as well.
Oh yeah,
wonderful John Fletcher. He was our coach at the National Youth Orchestra of Great Britain.
Oh,
and
sure.
And John was there, and John told the whole brass section to section one day. He said, "You know, we tubas don't really have to think. We just have to play on the beat." And he said, you have to practice that. And he put on a metronome and he played us on the beat for about, you know, 20 bars. And then he turned the metronome off and he played on the beat absolutely perfect. He said, this is what tuba players have to do. It was incredible.
He put another recording where a lot of things were happening on the beat. But that's something we can't talk about too much.
Okay.
Yeah, it's.
Okay.
So some people know this recording.
I don't know that recording.
Well, no.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Change of subject. A Peking Duck. Someone called Peking Duck is watching. I like your name. What led you down the path of performance? So when did you decide, okay, out of the trailer park, and that's what you wanted to do?
Yeah. Well, my high school music education scene was not too good. We had 2,200 students at my high school, and we had 25 people in the band. I mean, not very many at all.
Oh, gosh.
And I mean, we would make formations on the football field, and people are wondering, what the hell is that supposed to be? Because we were all spread out over, yeah, 100 yards, and, you know, what's that supposed to be? So we really didn't have that many, and I was very determined that I would be a band director, and I was, because I was really into being a band jock,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And there were all these great high school bands in the Los Angeles area, Loera and Glendora and all these, well, nobody knows those anymore, but these were really big, massive bands, you know, where half the school population was in the band. I mean, they just, you know, and here we had, you know, our little group. You know, so, but I really wanted to do that, and I wanted to be a music educator, and I had that in my sights through the first 2 years of college, and then I attended a concert. It was May 13th, 1973, San Diego, California, at the Civic Auditorium. My college roommate George Russell got these tickets for this visiting orchestra that came from the Midwest. It was a group from Chicago. It was this guy named Salty. And they were doing this this Fifth Symphony by a guy named Mahler.
Oh, Mahler.
Yeah, Mahler.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And Mahler. Yeah, got it.
And so, okay, well, let's go. So we popped in the Volkswagen and headed down to San Diego from Redlands, California, and here was the Chicago Symphony playing Mahler Fifth Symphony.
Wow.
And that changed everything that night. Came back.
Was that Jake on the tuba?
Yeah, yeah. And I never, Clevenger was playing, and the whole line of horns, of course. Kleinhammer was not on that tour, apparently. I think his wife was ill at the time, and so there was this really young guy named Max Bonecutter who was playing.
Max Bonecutter, what a name for a brass player.
Truly, yeah, yeah. And we ended up playing together in a couple of things much later.
And Bud on first trumpet?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Bud Herseth.
And Jay, the most impressive brass player of the bunch, because I didn't know anything about the Chicago Symphony then. I mean, you know, we're kind of isolated out in LA. Was Jay Friedman on first trombone. I mean, that was a very impressive.
I just bumped into Jay in the hall. He hasn't changed a bit.
Yeah, he's just
incredible.
He just keeps going.
He's Jay.
Just, you know, the ever ready battery.
Incredible.
Just keeps going.
So that changed your life.
Well, at least I did. I figured, you know, for as hard as it is to be a band director, I could probably just discipline myself, just to practice myself, and maybe do something like this for a living. And I was always impressed with the players like Jeff Reynolds on bass trombone and Bobo but that was kind of that's what kind of made me decide maybe it would just be. Maybe I should go for this playing thing. And Tommy Johnson was never pushed that. He never pushed. He always wanted you to be, make yourself marketable. You know, look into acoustics, look into arranging, look into recording engineer, being a recording engineer. Look at all these other things, because he knew that.
In LA, that's where the money was, not
well,
the tuba playing.
Truly, yeah, well, you know, he.
Clever teacher.
He knew that there weren't a ton of tuba jobs. I mean, you know, some people could say, well, you know, we had, you know, a pizza, you know, at the pizza parlor is going to hire a tuba quartet this weekend, you know, and yeah, like, you know, if the only way you're going to be paid is if you're going to get a cheese pizza, you know, you're not actually going to get paid money for something like that.
Cheese pizza is much more valuable, at least late at night after you've been playing a gig.
Oh. Hey, mind reader. That's what I had last night.
Oh, really? Oh, that's what I'm going to have tonight. The horns are going to take me for Chicago pizza. Pizza crust, pizza. You know, apparently it's like that thick.
Very thick, yeah.
Where would you recommend?
Eduardo's has always been a good one for me.
Is it close? Because it's cold outside.
Yeah, you're going to. Yeah, it's 5 degrees outside or something now today. It's just it's there's some driving snow, but I think they're going to do it relatively.
All
yeah,
right,
you'll have a good time.
If anyone's
yeah.
watching wants to join us, you know, come on down.
Yeah, it's like.
Do you know so many people watching that
concrete.
Want to say hello? I'm from Madrid. Did you read that? Scheherazade
yeah,
and
Jose.
I know them too. Hi guys. Yeah, that's where you're up. You're on. That's both of us.
Ah, okay.
That's mine. You can wave in it as well. They're watching. There's all sorts of people. I mean, cheers from Boston, from Frank, from LA, Jacob from Virginia. It's really, Zev Barden, it's so glad to see you live, Mr. Pokorny. What was the highlight of the season for you so far? Now that brings me on to a next question. Thank you for that wonderful question. Zev, you guys, I missed it.
Day.
You just premiered a low brass. Is that the first low brass concerto ever?
No. It's a low brass concerto. This one was written by Jennifer Higdon. And there have been a couple others.
Written for you guys?
No. There was actually Ray Primrue.
Oh.
You know him.
Yes,
he's a countryman.
Yes, he's a Brit.
He's a Brit.
Yes.
And he wrote one, I think.
Some great brass pieces.
Yeah.
Really fantastic stuff.
Yeah, he wrote some. Mulcahy was really close with him.
Yeah.
And he wrote a low brass concerto. In fact, it was done in Philadelphia, and Charlie remembers when, I guess he was, Charlie Vernon was there for the premiere of that. And unless I got the name mixed up, there was a fellow named Dubinsky. I may have this wrong, okay. But apparently this fellow was a string player.
Everyone watching will know. If you guys know any information about these low brass concertos, write them in, because we're happy. And also, can somebody put the link to the CSO brass video that you guys did about it, done by the wonderful Todd Rosenberg? He made this video in this room.
That's right. That's
and
right.
It's
That's
out
right.
there, and you guys are talking about it. And I loved what you said at the end of it. Basically, when you get to the end, you just blow everyone out of the room. That's how it finishes.
Yeah, it's... No, take no prisoners. Okay, there it is, finally. Three Fs.
But that's what the Chicago Brass do so well.
That's our reputation. You know, we do have a tendency to do that well, but we also, we do have a tendency to actually play things soft and lyrically, and I know that was one of the requests that when we spoke with Jennifer Higdon about this concerto that she was in the process of writing, that we wanted to show kind of our a softer, gentler side. And so,
you've got a softer and gentler side. Your dogs would be proud right now. How many do you have now? Your Basset Hounds?
We have four Basset Hounds.
Those are the most gorgeous dogs.
Oh, they're lovers.
They're the most gorgeous dogs.
They're lovers.
And when we get to this bit, I want a photo of them. Can Beth send me a photo of them? And we'll post it here in the Hangout.
We will do that.
Love Basset Hounds. So that's your softer, gentler side. And did you get a chance in the Low Brass Concerto to show your softer and gentler sides?
Yes. There are some places where we're just barely above the fabric line. Sometimes we're hell bent for leather, but a lot of times we're just below the fabric line, just kind of a loud refrigerator motor.
Loud refrigerator motor. It's a little bit like the air conditioning in this room.
Yeah, it's kind of strange because they are loading everything. I mean, people don't know that it's 50 degrees in here, and all we're doing is smelling number 3 diesel oil while the doors are all open, and they're cramming all those.
I know. It's such a shame with your tube. I would have liked to have seen it. Everyone else.
Yeah,
we'll do another one. I'll be back. There's a hello from Finland, from Aki, from Helsinki, and she remembers. Aki is a guy's name, isn't it?
I think so. I hope so.
Aki, yeah. I am very, Aki in Japanese is a girl's name, but I think it's a guy's name in Helsinki. Write in and tell us. Remembers Jean Solo from Mahler 6 in 2008 with Haitink. Haitink, it was very good. British humor.
Are you from London or Birmingham?
London.
You are from London,
yes, okay. I was born in the States. So I have a passport and a passport. I know you didn't know that, did you?
I didn't know
that. But this is your Hangout. And then we have Jarrett McCourt, who's watching from New World in Miami. Hi, Jarrett. I will see you next week. And you're going down too.
I'm
going down to New
World. How about that? Wow.
When are you going down there?
We're going down there.
Soon.
Let's see. Yeah, in about a week, something like that. We do our little thing in Washington, D.C.
I'm from the 10th to the 15th.
Oh. No, I don't have my calendar.
Well, we'll have a look. Jared, do you know when Jean's down there? Okay. Well, Jarrett says hi. Anyway, Elias from Tallahassee says, was it the Low Brass section who commissioned the work?
It's a co-commission of three orchestras. It was the Chicago Symphony, the Baltimore Symphony, and the Philadelphia Orchestra. So it wasn't the actual section that went ahead and commissioned it, but it was, you know, the management thereof. We in the Low Brass section on the 100th anniversary of the Chicago Symphony back, I guess it was 18 years ago. I can't even remember what year we're in right now. But we commissioned Jeff Reynolds to write a piece just for us.
And but you were involved in with the content of this Low Brass Concerto, or were the other Low Brass sections involved in that too?
I think Jennifer probably spoke with the other sections. I think she probably got more input from us than from others about a year ago.
Where can people hear it? In Carnegie Hall? Are you guys going to be recording it? Please.
Well, we'll tell the powers that be.
We will.
We'll be playing it in Carnegie Hall on the 10th or something.
On the 10th.
Is it the 8th?
Because we're there the same night doing a horn hangout with Julie Landsman and the Horns of the Met.
Oh.
And we're having a big party at Julie's after, and you're more than welcome to come.
Wow.
I've just invited all the Chicago Symphony horns to come. And so Julie's expecting a full house. You are more than welcome to join us.
Well, thank you very much.
So there we go. Jim Smelser is watching. He said, nice to be on the other side of a hangout. Thanks, Sarah. That's nice.
He's probably in the next room.
Probably. Hi, Jim. Joe Reddy says, hi, Jean. You'll always be an inspiration. Thank you very much. Aussie Tuba says, hi from Melbourne, Australia.
Wow.
I mean, people are really watching here. And Mark Weaver, Arkady Dubinsky Concerto Grosso, written for the New York Phil section in the 1950s.
Wow.
Thank you for that information. How many times have you played at Carnegie Hall? French Horn One asks.
Wow. I think the first time was with the Israel Philharmonic.
Israel Philharmonic.
Yeah, long time ago. That would have been in, I'm guessing it would have been 1976, because that was when the Israel Philharmonic had an American bicentennial tour, and we came to, Carnegie Hall then. So it was Zubin Mehta conducting. And
since then you can't count, because you guys go there really a lot. Quite a lot.
Yeah, it's been fewer times in recent years, but every couple years now, but it used to be once or twice a year, but you know, things are a little bit tight, but you know, every other year, that's fine. I mean, of course, the worst part of it is that the Carnegie Deli is shut down.
Oh, disaster. I didn't know that.
I mean, there's no point in even going back there.
No, we'll cancel all concerts immediately. And how do you get to Carnegie Hall? Oh,
goodness gracious. What was that?
I don't know. I think that was probably your microphone. It can stay down there. If the sound's still okay. You dropped your mic. Just don't move from the chair.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you get to Carnegie Hall, Gene?
You used to find the deli and then go down, turn left at 57th Street.
Practice. Thank you so much. That helps. You've got Philip Caspard from Geneva saying, looking forward to seeing you in Florence.
Oh, yes.
Kindest regards from Philip. And somebody called Beth.
Ah, indeed. Very good.
Hey, Beth. Now, Beth is the Mrs. And Beth says 9th at Carnegie Hall.
The 9th, okay.
The 9th. So she knows. Thank you very much. Beth knows.
She is the calendar. She's the one with the 3-digit IQ in the family.
3-digit. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, well, there's Beth, and then there's the 4 Bassetts, and then
and
I.
And then you.
And then
the 4 Bassetts combined IQ?
Well, I never really thought about that. Okay. They're all
we don't
always
want to tax
together.
Your IQ here.
No, it's don't.
Right, okay, back to Matt Kundler says, cheers, Gene, have a great tour. And Dan Morris says, greetings.
He came to the Redlands.
Brian J says, have a great tour. I mean, really, you've got so many people here. Let me just see, I just saw one here that I really like, but so many. Nathan said, could you talk about the legacy of Jacobs and the pressure of taking over for him? I would just like that, because he's such a big part of the CSO brass section evolvement. Do you say that? Evolution?
Yes, it was an evolution.
But it was his Dan Gingrich just said in the Horn Hangout, he said, it's song and wind. It wasn't all about wind. Everyone talks about his breathing in this, but there was a lot of song in there as well.
Yeah. Dan would have probably, certainly got a lot more of that than I ever did, because of course when I came into the orchestra, Jake wasn't playing in the orchestra anymore. So Dan heard it, four nights a week for many years. But
that's a lot of pressure to live up to, Gene.
Yeah. Well, he's my goodness. Jacobs was, of course, an ultimate player. You know, when he got in the orchestra in 1944 and kind of set up this thing that was happening on the bottom. And then a couple years later, Herseth came in 1948. And between the two of them, they pushed and pulled a bunch of very willing people in between, up and down and sideways and everything else. And that whole legacy of this brass section got started. It wasn't a creation of the PR department, because they didn't have PR departments back in those days, back in the late 40s, early 50s. But with these willing people in between, plus Jake on the bottom and Herseth on the top, it was a very, very big influence that happened. And it was an interesting, my first year in, I had just come from the St. Louis Symphony, and I had the good fortune of having my former music director from St. Louis conduct the Chicago Symphony. It was Leonard Slatkin, and he was a regular visitor at the time here. And so I asked him, I said, when he came in, what are the differences that you are hearing between having heard Jacobs here all the time? And
you spoke to conductors?
What's that?
You spoke to conductors?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Do you know some of them actually eat?
They eat as well.
Yeah, I know they're supposed to be, you know, beyond doing mortal things, you know, that human beings do and stuff, you know. But
that's quite a question.
Oh, it's
for him.
Well, the thing is, he was Leonard Slatkin. You could easily talk to him. He was great. He was just very easy to talk to. But what he said was, he says, well, for one thing, the brass section is not led by the first trumpet. In this orchestra, it really comes from the bottom. And on the bottom, you had Jacobs, who put a lot of punch on the first notes of everything that he played. That was kind of a style that he did because, well, for one thing, that's what this hall requires, because it's a rather dead hall.
But even since the renovation?
Yeah, that hasn't quite been solved. Mm-hmm. But I've done some research, and I listened to some very, very old recordings conducted by Stokowski of the old Philadelphia Orchestra with a guy named Donatelli playing. And if you listen really carefully to Donatelli play, he also plays with a lot of punch. And he was Jacob's first teacher back at the Curtis Institute. So they had this interesting way of playing where it never really quite was tenuto as much as it was kind of a marcato thing that was happening. And so, and it works in this hall. It really does, yeah. So.
Well, it's always been legendary. I mean, for me, the brass section of the Chicago Symphony is, I mean, you guys really are legends. I know that's a really difficult thing to put out there and get you to comment on it, but you are.
Well, yeah, the only thing we can, at least I can say, is that I'm just trying to fill these shoes and trying to do as best I can, and how people eventually, where I kind of end up in the mix is not that important at this point. But I just want to have just kind of kept up what was going on, and hopefully not brought it down by any big stretch. I mean, you know, I didn't have any say in picking me. You know, I'm a victim.
You're a victim. Oh my goodness, what the thing they did to you. I mean, how was your audition? Tell me about your audition. What did you have to play? And was it behind a curtain?
It was for a little while. Although I was brought in towards the end, so they had me come out there. They had me play a solo piece, anything I wanted to come in, and a lot of people.
And what was it?
I brought in this mindless transcription of Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun.
On the tuba?
Yeah. Did the first phrase in one breath.
No!
Eat your heart out. It was great. No, but you know, you could
Our
just
flute player, Manuel Pau, doesn't do it in one breath.
But Mathieu probably does.
Mathieu? I haven't heard Mathieu play, but I'm sure he could.
Yeah. Yeah, so other people were playing, you know, Strauss Horn Concerto and Hindemith and that's all well and good, except I looked at the audition list and it seemed like they were asking for a lot of Strauss and a lot of Wagner and Prokofiev and of course Respighi, and they were asking for a lot of really, you know, big shovel, you know, stuff. So I figured, okay, might as well show them something completely different. And so I did this, which was, and then what was strange about that was the pianist was not expecting this accompaniment to show up. And she said, well, maybe it'd be better you just go out and play it by yourself. I said, okay, whatever, you know, I'm a guest here. I don't know.
It's not that hard, the beginning of that film, to accompany. You just have to play a horn solo and a few strings.
Yeah, it just doesn't, you know. So I get out there to play and Schulte says, where's the piano player? You know, or something. I didn't even filter. I said, she didn't want to play it.
You said that?
Yeah, yeah. And
they noticed you were a man.
Oh, that's true. Well.
Well, okay, right. In those days, okay.
So he said, give me the part. You know, and he starts giving, and the pianist was right off stage and she was watching this whole thing happen. So she came running out and said, here, give me a part, I'll do it. So we sight read this thing.
So Schulte was going to play it on the piano for
Yeah,
you.
He was gonna.
Oh, what a shame he didn't.
I know, we could have gone on tour.
Yeah.
So, But I played that, and it was probably way under tempo, and probably was.
Well, that's impressive. Boring, way under tempo. You did it in one breath.
If I had a chance to do it, if I had a chance, I probably would never do it again. I mean, I recorded it once, and then, you know, it's just too nice a piece. I mean, you know, it's like trying to record a Puccini aria. I mean, once you've heard Pavarotti sing, you just don't want to mess it up. You know, I mean.
We'll leave it to that one to the flute players then, okay?
Yeah, I mean.
What else did you have to play? Or did you have to play this Respighi excerpt that makes us all giggle? Because when our tuba player got the job, Alexander von Puttkamer, who says a big hello.
Thank you.
He's probably tucked up in bed by now. It's very late in Berlin. All the tuba players had to play this boom, 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 boom. And the string players started to giggle. It was like, what is this? It's quite hard, isn't it?
There's a big outlay of air for that one. It's the Fountains of Rome, and you're going through a lot of air. It's very low, it's very loud. You're probably going through nearly 140 liters of air a minute, most of which never makes a bypass, even a side swipe into the brain at all. So you're just playing all this low stuff, and yeah, it's very challenging, and as I've told students at Roosevelt University and at Northwestern and on my seminar out in Redlands, California, it's not whoever plays that excerpt best. It's whoever messes it up the least. You know that actually
is it really ends one up of those? Being the
winner. It really is, because you can't. It just seems. You turn a corner and there's always something else. It's, you know, there's a pothole.
Did you have to play that one?
I believe so, yeah. And there was Ride of the Valkyries, because I remember having to play it with Charlie, and he
and
counts.
You played it with Charlie in the audition.
Yeah. It was towards the finals. The finals, okay. And Charlie kicks off, a one, two, three. You know? Everything's a one, two, three. You know, so. And I was ready to come in on the next one, but he counted it off for the two bars to suck the air in and the air and the hair going back and everything.
Hair?
Well, not for me.
No, but I don't remember. Never mind. Let's not talk about hair. I don't remember Charlie with a lot of hair either when I met him.
He is even less now. I mean, he does the Mr. Clean thing.
Mr. Clean, yeah.
Ooh. Yeah, going through airport security, he actually had a bottle of shaving cream, and they caught him with it, you know. And he wasn't gonna, and they were gonna take it, so he wasn't gonna waste it. So he just took this whole bottle of shaving cream.
What if it's security?
In security. It was an airport in Europe, and of course these people. What is this man doing? What is he doing over there? Oh my goodness! It's we never had people like that do something like this. You know, so Charlie, you know, and Todd Rosenberg, you know, like getting out the cameras and stuff, and Charlie goes through, and then of course he gets through the security.
So he put it on his head, but he didn't shave it. They were going to let him through with a shaver, but not a can.
No, that's interesting. I wonder how that happened.
Yeah.
He must have had a shaver. Maybe he snuck that one through.
Maybe he snuck that one through. Yeah. Well, if Todd's watching, we would like a photo of that, please. I need to see that. That's hysterical. I'm sorry, I'm ignoring all the questions because I'm just, I am so fascinated with everything you're saying. Could you just tell us about your seminar in Redlands? How can people get there? How long have you been doing? Practice. How long have you been doing it? What?
As of last year, that was the 10th year. And we just, Pokorny Seminar, Redlands, 2018. This year it starts on... a Monday, I believe it's June 14th or June 18th. I should have looked the date up, but it's happening a little bit earlier this year. I'm kind of dependent on the Chicago Symphony schedule.
Of course.
And
go to Ravinia as soon as.
Yeah. Well, there's usually 1 week in between, right. And
that's summer holiday.
Yeah, that's our summer holiday. Thanks a lot. 1 week. So, but this year, and that's usually when Mulcahy goes off and does his week-long thing at Northwestern, And I get to do my thing at sometimes we get Mulcahy to come out for a little while out in Redlands. But there's
Can
a week
Can I come as a low horn? I like to play in your
fourth register. Fourth horn. We'll have fourth horn excerpts.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. And there's great tacos.
Clayton Schaefer's written in June 18th.
June 18th.
Yep.
Excellent.
Thank you, Clayton. And then Scheherazade and Jose have written. Could you tell us about the Lalo Schifrin tuba concerto that you're premiering?
Thank you, Jose and Shara, for mentioning that. I got this phone call, and not so long ago, well, I guess about a year ago or something, and hello, my name is Lalo Schifrin. Is this Gene Pokorny? And I'm thinking, Lalo Schifrin, Mission Impossible. You know, this must be a crank call. This guy, he's probably a trucker from South Dakota, you know, he's doing something, you know.
Or a Three Stooges fan.
A Three Stooges fan or something. Yeah, just, you know. And the more I talk with this guy, I realize, you know, this is probably the genuine article. You know, and he wants to write a tuba concerto, and he asked around, and he found out that I would be a good one who might be able to play it. And so we started to collaborate, and I sent him a bunch of stuff that I've done. And
will it be in 5/4?
Yeah.
Was that 5/4 or 7/4?
No, it's 5.
I think it's 5.
It's still 5. But you know, he wrote the soundtrack to Cool Hand Luke, and Bullet, and he's written.
I would like to come. We'd like to live stream that, wouldn't we, Handsome Tim? I would like to come to your seminar.
Well,
he's thinking.
Yeah,
uh-oh.
I'm like. Listen, Andrew Glendening, who's the guy who runs everything at the University of Redlands, he's the dean of the school. The guy doesn't know the word procrastinate. He's probably already figured it out in the last 15 seconds.
Yeah.
Okay.
No. We'll be in touch.
March 3rd is the premiere with the Redlands Symphony Orchestra. So we get
March
done.
March 3rd.
Yeah, so it's coming up real soon.
Have you practiced?
As soon as I
it's
get done with
soon.
It.
It's very soon.
I know.
You've got a low brass concerto now.
Yes.
And the premiere on the 3rd of March. Wow. February only has 28 days.
Yeah, in fact, I only have
year.
A few more minutes for the.
Yeah, I know. We'd like to accompany you and live stream a bit of you practicing, but you don't have your tuba.
I know.
You've got a little one in the corner here. Which one did you bring
it's
us?
It's a Yamaha. It's one that's, it's a copy of the York tuba. And it's one that I play a lot. I have it at home, so I don't have to pull.
We're just
both.
Zooming in on it because look, Muti, good old Ricardo Maestro is looking over your. He's taking care of your tuba right now.
Excellent.
Zooming in on that. Thanks. So this is the one you practice on at home.
At home, yeah,
okay.
Yeah. And I have a. I also
you don't
have
still
a
live in a trailer park, do you?
No, okay. I graduated.
Graduated to a house.
Yeah. The pups are a lot happier about that too. So.
Do they live inside or outside?
Oh, inside.
Really? Inside?
I mean, yeah.
Do they sleep like on the bed and stuff?
No.
They're big dogs, Basset Hounds.
Well, they're long.
They're long. Yeah, but they're still.
Yeah, there's a neat thing about the Basset Hound breed that I've brought up to people, and that is if you played a long weekend of Bruckner Sevenths, you know, Bruckner Symphony Number 7, you walk in the house, you know, 11 o'clock at night, and you open the door and you see these Basset Hounds laying on the couch, and
that's
they
how you
look
feel.
And they look worse than you do. It really is just amazing. And then it's treat time, the fat one's home, okay.
What's your treat after a concert?
Sometimes I have some cereal.
Cereal? What sort of cereal?
Well,
I like cereal after a concert, too.
Yeah, it's,
I like muesli.
Granola.
My favorite muesli is almond and maple syrup muesli. It's probably the only healthy thing about that is that it's called muesli.
Yeah.
The rest of it's probably just sugar, but I
yeah,
like
but yeah, but they you probably have an umlaut.
That's
in
a
your,
muesli, that's right.
Yeah. You hear it's M-U-E. Yeah. Otherwise, I'll have a piece of cheese or...
Good old cheese.
Good old cheese.
I couldn't live without cheese.
Yeah, cheese is good.
That John Czerny, where are you watching from, John? Let us know. He wants to know what your favorite Bruckner symphony is. Well, it's obviously not the 7th.
7th is actually pretty nice, yeah. I love the 8th. It has that beautiful section for the second trombone and the tuba, that thing that goes up, I think it's the adagio movement.
Yeah. We sit in our orchestra, so if you're the conductor, we sit on the right-hand side in two rows, so the horns are next to the bassoons, and then the tubas go 1, 2, 3, 4, fourth tuba, bass tuba, third trombone, and then the trumpets are on the other side. So I sit next to the bass tuba for all our Bruckner symphonies, and it just gives me goosebumps, that bit in the eighth tuba. In the tuba and the second trombone. Ba ba da 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 da. Ba. Alexander plays that on a B flat, right?
Yeah, yeah. The fact that was.
And he's always doing this and this and that.
Yeah, there's. To get things in tune on a big tuba, you're pulling slides more than the trombone players.
It's a big thing, this B flat tuba versus the C tuba.
It is. It really is. I had a big, I was hoping I'd be able to actually talk about it here because when the big audition happened in the Berlin Philharmonic those years ago when Alexander won the position, there was all this talk about, you know, who's going to be the next tuba player in the Berlin Philharmonic. This is one of the biggest positions in the world. And Barenboim was interested in this thing about, because there was an article, an interview with Carol Jantsch in Philadelphia, and she talked about it, about the audition, and someone asked her whether she would audition for it, and she said, well, probably not, because she plays mostly, the big tuba she plays is double C, and what they ask for in Berlin is a double B flat. And Barenboim apparently read that, noticed it, and he was asking me about what's this double C, double B flat thing. And so I tried to explain it, but there's no real accurate way to describe it in words. And so I said, well, I'll tell you what, Maestro, why don't I go ahead, I'll try to get a double B flat tuba, because I don't have one, and I'll just do an A-B test for you. You will just get on stage, and he seemed to be happy with that. So it was getting right close up to his last week
because
with the Chicago Symphony.
This was the end. The brass changed to German trombones here, the trombones, and the trumpets would play rotary on the German repertoire.
Right.
You stuck to your C.
Well, it's the York tuba. You know, it's something that, you know, has been here since 1944, and, you know, so...
Yeah.
So I borrowed a double B flat tuba from Bill Adams, a local tuba player here who actually studied in Germany, and learned a couple excerpts, because it's a whole different set of fingerings for playing some of these excerpts. So I tried to learn these new fingerings and stuff and put together a couple excerpts, enough so that I could go back and forth and Barenboim could hear the difference. So he got out in the hall with my wife, Beth, and I played these excerpts. And he said, well, you know, I really need to hear this in the orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, so what does that mean? He said, well, why don't you play it for the rehearsal for Bruckner 9?
Just play. Yeah, I can imagine that.
I was like, holy crap. This is the end of, you know, I mean, this is a Sunday. I've got Monday to try to learn Bruckner 9th. Whole new set of fingerings, you know, because I hadn't played it. It's not an automatic thing, and you have, you know, your chops go in a certain place when you put a certain fingering down, you know. So, rehearsal. So we put it together, and he went from cue to cue to cue, just to listen, just to the tuba thing happen.
It's like a new audition.
Yeah, it was. And then he said, "Great." He said, "So we'll do this for the concert on Friday." You want this for the concert on Friday? Yeah, this was the penultimate concert he was giving in Chicago, his last week, because he was doing Mahler 9, Bruckner 9, and Beethoven 9. 3 days in a row. It was his last big hurrah in Chicago.
Couldn't he have asked for the B flat tuba in Beethoven 9? That would have been a lot.
That would have been crazy. Anyway, so, I mean, I was beyond being nervous. It was just, I mean... I had fingerings all over the part, and, you know, more missed notes than I had in the whole season and stuff. But there were a couple moments that evening when I happened to hit the right note, and it happened to center, and it happened to be going along with the rest of the trombone section, and things lined up, and I thought, wow, that really makes a difference, more than the C tuba. So I've been, now I'm doing a lot more double B flat tuba. I mean, I'm kind of...
I did not know that.
Yeah.
Wikipedia did not.
No, that. Wikipedia did not admit to that, I guess. So.
And you're admitting to that here live on the Horn Hangouts.
Live on the Horn thing.
Wow, so you guys, that's...
So doing some double C and double B flat.
So do you think it would be time actually for Alexander and our German tuba players to maybe do a little bit more C tuba? Because Simon Rattle asked us exactly the same thing.
Really?
He said, because, I mean...
And he wasn't run out of town?
No.
You know, because this is a real pride thing for the German.
I mean, we've never had, as far as I know, Alex has never played on a C tuba. And
probably
the Germans really don't, do they?
No. In fact,
there's some fantastic tuba players in Germany, really. It's Stefan Ambrosius in Munich, and there are really some really great
Thomas
tuba.
Keller?
Thomas Keller.
I do an A-B of a Mahler 7 between Chicago Symphony Recording and the Staatskapelle.
Yeah.
And Thomas is just
massive. What a sound, huh?
Yeah. He's great.
They call him Tuba Keller because Keller means cellar in German, so he's a tuba seller.
Yeah.
He's a really sort of like a seller with a C, not an S.
Yeah. Right. His parents are
butchers.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right. He likes his sausages. Speaking of food, Tuba J just said, "What's your favorite spot to eat around Symphony Center?"
Oh gosh.
Is it Eduardo's for the pizza?
No. You know, we had a really good Italian place. Pazzo's, it just went out of business. I guess I wasn't visiting them often enough. There is actually Exchequer is kind of
is
okay.
Miller's.
What's that?
They
Miller's?
Shut Miller's. I mean, I don't know if that was your favorite place. Miller's. We always went there.
Yeah, the pizza there is very good. Yeah.
Your wife has just written in, said you were the only player Barenboim gave a bow to after that concert.
Yeah. I missed more notes than I had in the whole year. Thanks a lot, Maestro. Appreciate it, you know. I remember you too. I love Barenboim. Beth and I saw him just last year. We went out to Paris, and
when you was at the Staatskapelle.
Yeah, the Staatskapelle.
We played together in the Staatskapelle. Barenboim got you over for Siegfried. You were
yes,
the worm.
Yes, it was the only time I ever went through the
on your
the ring
tuba.
Cycle. Yeah.
Shame on you.
I know. I was a bad boy, and Stefan Schultz was, you know. He was playing contrabass, trombone, and
you two were a good couple. You two. Now we've got him now in the Berlin Phil. Both of us defected, which I don't think went down very well. But I hope we've been forgiven.
Well, you know,
that's a whole new hangout theme.
I would guess.
Yes, there's a quick question. This guy Elmer has been writing it in quite often. He just wants to know a few words about your experience with Bud Herseth. Because Bud, I mean, I wish we'd been able to get him on the Horn Hangouts. I remember when I was doing my first gigs with you in Ravinia, I could hear him mumbling about, Furt Wengler did that a lot better than this young guy. I can't even remember who was conducting, but it was, his tempers are on wrong. Furt Wengler did it better. He would just sort of, he would mumble and comment.
Yeah, one side of his mouth.
And you could hear it. It carried really well.
Yeah, he got the Alexander Graham Bell Communications Award. You know, everybody could hear his snide comments except for the conductor. Well, of the three levels of maturity of players, being dependent, independent, or interdependent, he was certainly the example of being independent. He always had his act together, and he was always ready at the first rehearsal. He was always a great example for just getting your own stuff together, and he was no excuses.
Last day. He was incredible, wasn't he?
Always excited. You know, he's always experimenting with new mouthpieces and stuff. And I think about, you know, the common thing that happens out in Europe where there's a mandatory retirement
65.
Age at 65. And, you know, and Herseth, you know, when he was well into his 70s, he was always experimenting with new things and new mouthpieces. He was always just trying to keep things going, and I knew people 40 years old who were retired on the job. You know, you can't just assign a a clock to this. You know, it's the compass, and he definitely had the compass going, you know, right to the end.
Dave Griffin told us on the Horn Hangout, CSO Horn Hangout, that Dale Clevenger was exactly the same. That in Dale's last week of rehearsals, the penultimate rehearsal, he was still writing things in his part. This was really impressive. You know, Dale was also right up to the very last day completely involved. I just remember my brother Alistair, who's a conductor. You know Alistair Willis. He's done a few conductors.
I didn't know that.
That's Alistair. My brother. He's conducted you guys on occasion. Yeah, he's now a chief conductor in South Bend. And he said to me, for conductors coming here, one of their most feared moments is when you hear Maestro, and you think, oh, it's Dale.
yeah, the Dale's. Yeah.
Maestro, and you just think, oh.
Dale would ask the questions.
And if you were a young thing like my brother was, you learned to fear that. Good for Dale.
That's funny.
Thanks for answering that question. And Bobby says, thanks for being so gracious for us young tuba players. John wants to know, are the shirts available? Yes, John, they are. Look on my website. You can buy them. They support the Horn Hangouts. If people want to buy these, all the proceeds go to our Horn Hangouts, because we run ourselves, and turning into a bit of an expensive hobby if you see all this equipment. And handsome Tim came all the way from Melbourne for this, and we do actually have a present for you. You don't have to pay for it. We have a Horn Hangout t-shirt for you.
Holy moly.
And I hope it might be a bit big for you, but sure.
That'll be a first.
But if it fits and you feel like wearing it, there are many people that are very proud to wear that around the world. And
it is only an XL.
I know, but you're only an XL. We'll try it on later. We have another one here just in case.
It's kind of otherwise.
We have an XXL here too.
There we go. Good. Yeah, High Fidelity did a review of my first CD, and they said it was an example of a 5-pound ham in a 3-pound sack. So
we want a 3-pound ham in a 5-pound sack. No, that's a terrible comparison. Well, it's funny because someone just asked, Low Brass 101 said, who can eat more, you or Charlie?
I think Charlie has the... We haven't done that in a while. Although, I tell you, if you get Charlie into an Italian restaurant, and I don't think... no holds barred.
Impressive. I've experienced
he's,
that.
Yeah, yes. I think pasta is one of his favorite friends.
We have been hanging out for over an hour. Usually the hangout's about 45 minutes because I run out of questions. The online viewers run out of questions. They're still coming. And you guys, write in your questions or write in for Gene. He'll get to see all these questions. So we'll know about what to talk about on the next hangout, because I am so coming back, and we're going to meet the CSO tuba, and you're going to play après-midi for us in one breath.
On double B flat tuba.
Double B flat tuba. That's it. You better start getting practicing now.
Oh my God! And we'll have a dancer.
We'll have a dancer.
Charlie
in a tutu.
That's right. He'll do his black belt.
He will do a tutu. But Mattson asked a lovely question that we'll finish off with. What inspires you in life? What do you wake up every day? What inspires you?
Well, I know that. I keep thinking that the best of life is still around the corner. I'm inspired very much by the writings of Stephen Covey, his 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. The ideas that he puts forth there, especially the idea of sharpening the saw, which is renewal for your physical, your mental, your spiritual, your social, emotional. And there's always important things to do, and they might not be urgent, but there are important things to do in life. And I'm very much inspired by that. It doesn't mean that I'm getting any better at it. In fact, I realize how much further I'm falling apart. I'm extremely lucky to have had the time here in Chicago. And to play in this orchestra, I pinch myself every time I walk up the stairs.
I know
to
that
be here.
Yeah.
And I try to keep it going as much as I can because I enjoy it so much. And I know the clock is ticking, and I hope I have the smarts to get the hell out of Dodge when it's time, because I don't want to spend, this orchestra is much more important than it is for my ego to stay on longer than I should stay. I love riding the wave. I'm so lucky. That's it.
Gene, you're making me fall apart here. And you, thank you for that. You're such an inspiration to all of us, really. And this orchestra, you are a legend. Thank you for doing this hangout.
Thanks so much for having me. Thanks for your questions. And
yeah, thank you guys for joining in. And what a hangout. Thank you. Come back soon.
Certainly.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
See you soon.
Bye.